We've already learned how to find the inverse of a 2x2 by computing it. The question that we have now is, how do we compute this for a general n by n matrix? This could be a 3x3 or a 4x4 or larger matrices. One way, of course, to do this is with technology, which is often the way we do it, but it has a lot of merit to understand what is happening when a calculator computes it. So first of all, we just need to remember that inverses only exist potentially for n by n matrices. Now, I just want to point out here that this is not all n by n matrices have inverses, but only n by n matrices potentially have inverses. So if you have a 4x7 matrix, it will not have a mathematical inverse. And the real reasoning here is because we know that A inverse is a matrix such that, let's write ST, such that if we take A and we multiply it by A inverse, we get the identity matrix. Now, that's key here because the identity matrix, when it multiplies any matrix, will produce the exact same matrix you started with. Okay, so the identity matrix, which we can denote I2 if we're talking about two dimensions, is the matrix 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay, that's a 2x2 matrix. I3 is the 3x3 identity matrix, which contains the standard basis vectors as its columns, and so on. So these are all square matrices. And the idea here is that if I take any 2x2 matrix and I multiply it by I2, I get that same matrix I started with. If I take a 3x3 matrix and multiply it by I3, I get the same matrix I started with. Now, if it were possible to find the inverse of a, let's just entertain this idea of a 3x4 matrix, and let's just say hypothetically that there was some A inverse matrix that gave us an identity. Now, that matrix would have to have the same size as A, so the A inverse would have to be 3x4 as well. And we can't multiply a 3x4 matrix by another 3x4 matrix, so this simply will not work. By the definition of what an inverse is, it produces a square identity matrix. To motivate the idea of how we would actually find the inverse matrix for an n by n matrix, let's start off with a simpler example. Suppose we want to find the inverse of a scalar, say 10. We want to find a value 10 inverse such that 10 multiplied by that inverse is equal to 1. So in this case, x is going to be 10 inverse. Now, we know from our understanding of working with real numbers that this is just going to be 1 over 10. For matrices, it's not quite this simple. We can't just take 1 over all the components because the way matrices multiply is not the same way scalars multiply. We have the matrix vector products that take place. So the way we would normally start off doing this to solve for, well, what is x, is we would divide both sides by 10. And this would tell us that x, which is the same thing as what we're calling 10 inverse, because remember, an inverse is a number such that when you multiply it by itself, you get 1, and that's equal to 1/10 for that reason. And so we just call that 10 inverse. It's not really 10 to the negative 1, although that's how we often talk about it in algebra. Now, another way I could approach this, an equivalent way I could approach this, is by multiplying both sides by 1/10. Right? So rather than dividing by 10th, I'm actually multiplying by the reciprocal of 10 over 1, which is 1 over 10. And in this case, the 10s cancel out. I get 1x is equal to 1/10 times 1, which is 1/10. So that's sort of method 2 that we can use. Now, the other way I'm going to write this is in a matrix form, which is really unconventional. It isn't a way that we would often write it, but if I'm solving a system of equations, in this case, we can think about 10x equals 1 as a system of equations. It's really a system of one equation with one variable. So we would write this as a vector equation. We could say that this is really 10x is equal to 1. And both of these are just 1 by 1 matrices. And then we could kind of factor out the x. We could write this as the matrix 10 times the matrix containing x, using that idea of matrix vector multiplication. This is not a very interesting case since these are just both 1 by 1 scalars. And we want to solve for this matrix 1, right? Okay, so think about this as AX is equal to B. And the way we could solve this is that we could take the matrix containing the coefficient of our variables vector, which in this case is just one variable, augment it by 1, and then use row reduction to get this into reduced row echelon form. And really, just in this case, it amounts to multiplying the first row by 1/10. And so that will give me the matrix 1 augmented by 1/10. Now, this is already in reduced row echelon form, because by definition, it just means that in every row, there is a leading 1. Above and below that leading 1, there are only zeros. And any zero rows are placed at the bottom, which is not relevant in this case. And so what we kind of have here, if you notice, this is sort of the 1 by 1 identity matrix. I'm going to refer to this as I1. Okay, that's the identity matrix. Why? Well, because if you multiply the identity matrix by anything, it doesn't change the value. If I multiply anything by 1, it does not change the value. And what I have over here is the inverse of A, which was just the scalar 1. So notice what I did. I took the A matrix here. I took the identity matrix, placed it here, conducted the reduced row echelon form, and ended up with the identity on the left. We can call this I1 over here as well, and A inverse on the right. Now, this may seem like a very roundabout, unnecessary way to do it, but this is the same idea we use in linear algebra when we have a coefficient matrix that is 2 by 2, 3 by 3, 4 by 4, etc. So the idea is similar for a system of equations AX equals B. We want to find a matrix A inverse such that AX equals I. So here we're going to think about this as being the inverse matrix, right? Because it's only a matrix multiplied by its inverse that will give us I. All right, well, so what I can do in this equation is I can multiply both sides by A inverse. Giving me A inverse A X is equal to, and then multiply by A inverse on the right-hand side as well. Right here, I'm going to get the identity matrix, an inverse multiplied by a matrix, by its matrix. And over here, I get just A inverse. So I get IX equals A inverse. So to set this up in a similar form as we did up here in kind of concept 3, since I'm trying to solve for this matrix, in this case X, I can build the augmented matrix corresponding to A being on the left, augmented, in this case, not by a B vector, but by the identity matrix. And we can see here that when we solve that system for x, well, these are just going to be the coefficients of that x matrix, if you will. And computing the reduced row echelon form of this, well, we're going to get the identity matrix on the left-hand side. That's kind of what we've done here. And then on the right-hand side, when we solve that system for the X matrix, we get A inverse appearing over here. So the only difference here between solving a system and solving this system is that we're going to have a matrix that is an augmented matrix consisting of two matrices, A as well as I. So let's put this into practice for an example. Let's say that we have the matrix A equals, and I'll go ahead and put in a few components here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And let's say I want to compute the inverse. What is A inverse? Well, A inverse will be found exactly the way we've set it up here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and I think I'll place a 10 here. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10, augmented by the identity matrix. Now, since A is 3 by 3, that means the identity will be a 3 by 3 identity matrix. 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. So I have the A matrix augmented by the identity matrix. Now I'm going to row reduce this, the reduced row echelon form of this matrix. So what I'm going to end up with is, hopefully, if that inverse does exist, I should have the identity matrix here augmented by the A inverse matrix on the right. So this is not fun to do by hand unless you enjoy doing these types of things. So I'll use a matrix calculator, create a new matrix. This has three rows, but it has two sets of three columns, so it'll have six columns. One on the right will be one, on the left will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then 10. Augmented by 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Now I want to compute the reduced row echelon form of that matrix. And notice that on the left, I do get the identity matrix, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. And I get some decimals here. I could have it convert to fractional form. And so we have negative 2/3, negative 4/3, 1. And then I have negative 2/3, 11/3, negative 2. Negative 2. And lastly, I have 1, negative 2, 1. Okay, so this matrix off to the right is going to be the identity, I'm sorry, the inverse matrix of A. Now, how can I check? Okay, so I'll put this little arrow over here that we just found the inverse. How do I check? Well, as a check, I should be able to verify that if I multiply A inverse by A, or A by A inverse, you know, think back to the 1/10, 10 times 1/10 and 1/10 times 10, both produce 1. So I should get the 3 by 3 identity matrix. So let's come back over here. I'm going to go ahead and create a new matrix, two new matrices, in fact. I'll create our original matrix, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10. And then I'll also create the matrix corresponding to our inverse that we claim is the inverse, negative 2/3, negative 4/3, 1, negative 2/3, 11/3, negative 2, and then 1, negative 2, and 1. Now, notice that the names of these matrices are B and C, so if I multiply B times C, I should get the identity, which I do. And if I multiply C times B, I also get the identity, and everything is good. Let's try one different thing here, and I'll just point out here that we've successfully found the inverse. How do we know if the inverse matrix doesn't exist? Well, in short, A inverse does exist if you can take the augmented matrix A augmented by I, get it into reduced row echelon form, and end up with the identity on the left and A inverse on the right. Okay, if you don't get the inverse, if you don't get, must get this, if you don't get the identity matrix on the left, then what's on the right doesn't matter. The reason comes back to this right here. If we're trying to solve AX equals I, A times what is equal to the identity, where in this case X is the inverse matrix, and let's just say that you don't end up, let's say that you multiply by some matrix that you're claiming to be A inverse over here, and the reason I'm putting quotes around it is because it's going to be a fake inverse, then let's just say that this does not equal the identity. Well, that means that if this doesn't equal the identity, then that matrix, whatever it ends up being, times X, is not going to give me A inverse. Okay, so let's just demonstrate this real briefly here. Let me come back up to our matrix, and you notice that I used 10 here instead of 9. Okay, let's just say that I used 9 in that place. Well, in this case, the reduced row echelon form is no longer the identity on the left. Okay, let me put that back to 10. There it is with 10. We get the identity on the left, but that value being 9, now we get some remnants of the identity. We get the 1 and the 1 on the diagonal. We have a 0 here, 0 here, 0 here, 0 here. We don't have a 1 here, and then we don't have zeros above it because there's no 1 that could cancel those out in the row reduction process. So let's just say naively, I thought, well, oh, I found it. The thing on the right is always A inverse. So let me change this back over here. This was our original matrix. And let's just say I looked at this and thought 0, negative 8/3, 5/3. 0, negative 8/3, 5/3. And then I thought that 0, 7/3, negative 4/3 was the next row. And 0, 1, negative 2, 1 was that next row. So now if I multiply BC, if this matrix is in fact the inverse of this matrix, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, I should get the identity by definition of what the identity is. Now the product still works out, but it is very far from anything even remotely close to the identity matrix. So C is not the inverse of B for that reason. And C times B produces something close to the inverse matrix, but once again, it is not the identity matrix. And therefore, if you do not end up with the identity matrix on the left-hand side, then A inverse does not exist. So I'm going to point that out here. If you end up with anything but I on the left, after reduced rho echelon form, the inverse does not exist. Now, we'll see in a future lesson that there is something called the determinant to help us determine for a 3x3 or a 4x4 whether or not there is a multiplicative inverse. But here's one way to find out if all you're looking to assess is whether the inverse exists. You can go through this process, and if you end up with the correct result, then the inverse does exist. If you don't, then the inverse doesn't exist.